We have two great brains now with us here, two, I think, great leaders in their jobs, and two visionary leaders. We're talking now about with Chris Curtin. He's the Chief Brand and Innovation Marketing Officer from Visa, and Jean-Marc Payot, Head of Group Market Management and Distribution, Chief Marketing and Distribution Officer from the Allianz. And we are very happy to have a real expert talking to them. Ladies and gentlemen, Global Chief Digital Officer from Mediacom, Deirdre McGlashan is with us. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to From Digital Transformation to Innovation. Careful. Hello. Bonjour. Good morning.
Thank you. So, Jean-Marc, Chris, okay. Both of you guys have a similar remit in that both of you guys have been asked to take your companies, your respective companies, and transform them. Transform the companies themselves and transform the brands in this new era. So that's a mighty big remit. So I'd like to start, before we kick off, for each of you guys to share with us what your vision is. Now, Jean-Marc, you told me something really funny earlier today. I asked Jean-Marc how he started in this, and he shared with me the story of what the first words his boss said to him when he asked him to take the role. And Jean-Marc said, "Why me?" And he said, "Well, you're French, and I need to do a revolution, so I need a French guy."
That's really right.
So why don't we start with you? Tell us about Allianz and what it is that you're driving there. What is the vision?
I think it's quite clear. We are we were built in 1885, 88, something like that. So we are an old company, strong run. The main values of Allianz are solidity, integrity, resilience. And when you are a company like that, and when you are living in the world where we are living in, you are obliged to think about transformation and innovation. So we have decided to work on these three pillars. We try to improve our current business, which is normal, and we are not so bad to do that, because I think we are the most profitable insurance company in the world since the last 6 years. So we know how to do it, but we have at the same time to transform the company to reach the needs and the behaviors of what we call the digital naturals in between 18 and 35 years old. And at the same time, we have to prepare the future. And to prepare the future in this world is to innovate, which is completely different. It's a completely different job, completely different approach. And we have to work on that. And to work on that, we have developed what we call the innovation turbine. But I will probably have the occasion to talk to be more precise about that. Mm-hmm. So improve the current business, transform the current business, and innovate, which is completely different.
Okay. Fantastic. And Chris, share with us what your vision is for Visa.
I mean, the Visa vision is to be the best way to pay and be paid for everyone, everywhere. And, you know, we wanted that to be a vision that represented, you know, yesterday's Visa, today's Visa, and tomorrow's Visa. And so, you know, the vast majority of commerce still occurs in the physical world, but the highest growth rates are in e-commerce and m-commerce, and one day the Internet of Things. And so I think that day is upon us now. And so, you know, this vision that we have for us kind of, I think, we kind of represents us on our best days, and it also is like a mission statement for us to make sure that whether it's a product or whether it's a service or whether it's a partnership, that we stand for the best. And we define every single day the best, both within our company but also within our category, which is seeing innovation come from individuals, institutions, from different geographies, both in the developed and the developing world. So it's an incredibly exciting time both to be in the category of payments, but also in the craft of marketing.
And both of you guys have spoken about partnerships, and both of your companies do a lot with partnerships. For example, you both sponsor Formula E. Can you guys tell us a little bit about your partnerships, how you choose them, and why you've chosen particular ones?
Yeah. You want me to start, or?
You can start.
Okay. I don't want to preempt the Frenchman revolutionary. No, I think we try to be really selective about the partnerships that we strike, and we try to ensure that the sponsorships or the platforms with whom we affiliate or through whom we come to life, whether it's the Olympics or the NFL or World Cup, you know, stand for what we stand for as a company and as an identity. And so that also applies to athletes. You know, in the context of athletes, we assume your athleticism is unquestioned. It's your character that we're interested in. And it's your character for many reasons, some of which is you represent us in and through the media, some of which is you represent our clients. And frankly, some of these athletes are brands in and of themselves and are social media agents in and of themselves and are kind of entrepreneurs in and of themselves. In fact, we did a little demo test that didn't go to consumers, but did go to clients and media, which was this payment ring for the Rio Olympics last year that was waterproof and that ultimately required no recharging. It actually got its battery life from the infrastructure itself wirelessly. And we had a number of athletes, including Ashton Eaton, who's a decathlete, it's called the world's greatest athlete, demo this for us in Rio. And it was just so exciting to see them represent Visa and the type of technologies we're trying to deploy.
That's amazing. And Jean-Marc, you are also heavily invested in drones. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a bit about that? Why drones for an insurance company?
It's a very good question. In fact, I'm not as lucky as you. We have really a very few amount of money to invest. Right. We are a German rooted company, and in a German rooted company, the costs are really constrained. Mm-hmm. So we were obliged, as we say in France, when you don't have money, you need to have ideas and you need to be smart. So we were obliged to find a new solution to be present in this partnership ecosystem, in the sport ecosystem, and to find new ideas and new ways to invest our money. So that's why we have decided, it was 1 year ago, it was one of my first decisions when I arrived 1.5 years ago, to go from Formula One, which was the traditional partnership we had on the sport ecosystem, to stop the partnership with Formula One and to go into what we have called at this moment the digital sport. Mm-hmm. And from the beginning, it was just a communication strategy and a partnership strategy. But it became much more than that. It became what I call the window on this new ecosystem, new business sectors. And now we are using this partnership as an entry door to acquire the credibility and the legitimacy on these new ecosystems to be able to co-shape, to co-create with these guys, these innovative guys, this ecosystem, and to try to find new business for us and new markets for us. And to come back to your question, when we have begun to invest with the drones, and we have co-created with the DL Allianz World Championship, which was an amazing experience, an amazing adventure with them, because from the beginning it was just 5 races in the United States. Now it will be this year more than 9 races using our platform, our stadium platform. We'll create together new races in the stadiums for normal people, face to face. You can see the race. It will not just be broadcasted or on internet or with ESPN, Sky, or ProSieben, or Canal Plus. It will be really a physical experience to see these drones. You will be within the Star Wars because it's like that. So we began with drones. We went to Formula E. After that, we went to Robocar, and we are also partner with Visa, with Robocar, which shows that we share the same vision of the future. Yeah. And now we invest on digital chess, robot fights, all the more crazy things you can imagine. But these are crazy things for us, not for part of the people in the room, because for digital natives and digital natural, it's just a normal life.
Right.
Yeah, just to give you a last information, a figure, the last drone race in the United States was broadcasted by ESPN. Mm-hmm. And they had 300,000 viewers. The last Formula One race, what broadcast is as well by ESPN, they are 170,000 viewers, which means that a drone race make 2 times more awareness than a Formula One race in the United States. Yeah. Just to give you an idea.
That's really interesting, because now we're looking at, you know, what are the new sports for this new generation of people? And as you said, we might find it odd and try to understand why insurance would be involved in drones outside of insuring drones, but you're right, it is the new sport. And as you said, sport, athletes, and the personalities are so important for your brands.
Right.
So for you guys, I mean, both of you have amazing visions, amazing partnerships. How do you make it happen within the company? I mean, I think that internal transformation has got to be as much of a challenge as selecting the right partners and making sure that they're completely aligned with where you guys are trying to go. How do you drive that change internally?
I mean, I don't know that there's any, you know, specific formula that's found in a textbook on business. I think a couple of things that I've seen at the different companies that I've worked in, but it's pronounced at Visa, is, you know, to move from nouns to adjectives. So, you know, to the extent that you can have a strategy, less a strategy department and more a strategic company, to the extent that you can have less an innovation team and more of an innovative company, I think is the type of company that we would like to be and the type of company that we encourage. You know, we're a big brand, big global brand, but we're really numerically a rather small company. We have a perspective within our management that every big company wants to be small and every small company wants to be big. And, you know, we try to harness that and we try to sit right in between the two. And mm-hmm. so we can like punch above our weight. We also have a philosophy that says, you know, if someone were to come in and take your job, it's just a human filter to apply, which is if they came in and did your job, what are the six or seven things that they would take about what you're doing mm-hmm. and do it exactly the same way you're doing it? Okay. What are the two or three things that they would introduce that you would never have done? Or, and what is the one or two things that you both think should occur, but they would do it and you wouldn't do it? And so it creates this filter that you can apply to yourself of like, well, then why shouldn't I be doing that now? And why shouldn't I be getting after that? And I think finally, it's really important to have a founder's mentality within the company. Like, this is your company. For however long you're at that company, it is your company. And you're not just employed by that company. It's what you've chosen to do with, you know, 60-70% of your week. And so make it matter, make it count, like have pride in what you're doing and what your colleagues are doing and make sure that that's inculcated.
Mm-hmm. And how about for you?
I fully share what you have said. Yeah. I would say that I would just take an example. My uncle is 91 years old. Okay. He's 80% of this time on his iPad. He's sending me emails, Snap. He has a FaceTime with my son in the United States, and he's 91 years old.
Yeah.
So it's exactly what we aim to be.
Right.
We aim to be the oldest startup in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to be strong and at the same time to be fast. And it's what is difficult to reach as an objective. And to do that, I think there are two main rules. The first one is to change the culture, and the second one is to give the vision. Mm-hmm. If you have the vision, and if you are able to explain in a very, very simple way to all your employees that what you want to do is to transform the company and to push for innovation, and if they see that you deliver and that you stick to this objective, for them it becomes really inspiring. And when you have inspired employees, you have not to ask for innovation. The innovation is coming by itself. Mm-hmm. The people prefer to innovate than to stay on their seat. I never seen anybody arriving in the morning and say, I will have a boring day and I'm happy about that. You want to be inspired, you want to be invested, you want to be engaged. Mm-hmm. And if you have the vision, if you know where you have to go, it's much easier. And what is interesting is to see is the fact that innovation could be at a high level, when we invest with, for example, Robocar to prepare what will be the insurance for autonomous driving, autonomous vehicles in the future. Mm-hmm. This is high level innovation. But at the same time, each guy, we have a project named Pebble in the Shoe, and the idea is very simple. When you have a pebble in the shoe in your current work every day, you can innovate, you can find a solution, you have the capacity to do that. And in some OEs, it's not in all the OEs, all the branches, worldwide we have 67 countries. But in the main countries, we have a specific budget which is affected to each smallest team, and they can use this budget to invest, to find a solution, mm-hmm. to innovate and solve the problem that they have in their day life, which is quite interesting. And innovation is like that. It's like digital, it's liquid, it's everywhere.
You know, I'd love to follow up on that, because I think mission and purpose are so important, not just to the outward-facing part of a company, but to employees. Why they come, why they stay, why they do what they do. I'm always reminded of the story of John F. Kennedy, who went down to check on the NASA program, and he was being shepherded through this tour, and he was with the astronauts and with the generals, and they were telling him, Mr. President, here's what we're doing, here's how we're going to use the Apollo program and all the rest. And John F. Kennedy spotted a man who was effectively a janitor, with a push broom underneath the rocket. And he walked over to him and he said, you know, my name is John F. Kennedy. And he goes, what's your name and what do you do? And he expected one answer. And instead, the man said to him, I'm Mr. President, I'm blank, blank, blank. I'm here to put a man on the moon. And I think that that sense of mission and that sense of purpose transcends whatever role, whatever title, whatever impact you may think within the company, and there's a contagious effect to it. So I think it can't be understated.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. But I think in order to have the people behind you, people have to have an intellectual curiosity. You know what I mean? They have to lean in and want to be part of the team. That janitor thought of himself as a key part of the team that was putting a man up on the moon. So I'm sure in your careers you've come across barriers as you've been trying to get things done as well. Can you tell us a little bit about those and how you might have come around to overcome them? Because I think people in the audience, like myself, really want to learn from your experience to not necessarily take your exact innovation and tactics, but to take a lot of the learnings of how you guys got there into our own businesses and into our own lives.
I can give you our vision. I think, again, that the main objective you have to reach is to have this vision, to be able to define on one page, on one slide, what is the global objective you have. What is your vision? After that, you have your strategy, and when you know that, it's quite easy to take the people within the strategy. But it takes time, because when you do that, you have to tackle all the questions linked to the culture of the company. Mm-hmm. But it works when you are engaged, committed, when the objective is clear, when the vision is clear, and when you have the capacity to explain this vision to all the stakeholders around you. And I'm not talking just about the board members, I'm talking about your colleagues, but I'm talking about the people behind them. Mm-hmm. It means that you have to do many presentations, you have to explain and explain and explain again. It's a long shot. Your vision, your strategy, when you do that and you stick to that, and when you deliver at the same time, you can embark and you can take all the company with you and transform the company. Mm-hmm. But from the beginning, you need to have a vision. If you don't have a vision, to say we want to innovate is not enough. You have to explain what it is, you have to show what you want to do, you have to stick to that and to be consistent for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years to transform the company. Mm-hmm. And in addition, I would say that you need a fantastic CEO with a big balls. Mm-hmm. Because if not...
Yeah.
I mean, I think there are a couple of different elements. I don't think you can discount, you know, just...
Also, remember, we're talking about barriers as well. What kind of barriers have you come across?
Yeah, I think corporations and life, there's a natural inclination to have some form of atrophy set in. Yeah. And to have, you know, kind of a routine dominate the way you think and the way you, you know, kind of perform your daily habits. And I'm not sure... That's the way the world works. It's certainly not the way your competitors work. Mm-hmm. So I think you have to deploy a couple of things. Number one is you constantly have to think about working smart, not just hard. You got to think about what is this meeting all about? What are we here to do? And mm-hmm. does it really require 60 minutes? Or does it really require 38 slides? Or what's the heart of what we're trying to communicate? And let's do it quickly. I think second is, while you need subject matter experts, I also think you need employees that I would refer to as human Swiss Army knives. Okay. People who are capable of doing any number of things, and frankly, hardwired to do so. Like, mm-hmm. just like we all are in life, you know, you want to be able to do finance as well as you could do legal, as well as you could do marketing, as well as you could do sales. I mean, that's life. And then I think third is something that I'm not sure people talk enough about, at least within marketing, and I think there's a tenacity that's required, a stick-to-itiveness and a resolve that it's just so important, particularly in, you know, places like Silicon Valley and elsewhere, but that gets you up in the morning and then have that kind of pilot light within you want to change the world.
Yeah, and I think also to add to that, also the flexibility and the almost embracing of change. I know the two of you two were talking earlier in the speaker's lounge and you guys were discussing who your competitive sets are. And not only do you have the competitive sets within each of your verticals, but pretty much anyone and everybody has become your competitors.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
And how do you deal with that? You know what I mean? So that becomes really interesting as well.
That's why we have no choice.
Yes.
We have to transform the business model and we have to innovate, because if we don't do that, the next, the future clients will never buy an insurance. I always give the same example. Some years ago, when you were 18 years old, the main objective was to pass your driving license and to buy a car, because it was freedom.
Exactly.
For the what we call, again, the digital natural, for them, they pass a driving license because they think I could someday need to drive a car. But for the digital natives, they don't even think about passing their driving license because they have so many opportunities with sharing economy, with Uber, with the new bus lines, with trains, with planes, with everything, that they think about mobility, not about car insurance. So we came from car insurance to driver insurance, and now we have to think about mobility insurance. If we are not able to do that, the railway companies or Amazon or any actor on the market can become an insurer. Yeah. Of course, they have to acquire the technical expertise to do that, but they can do that because they will have the data of these people. When you have the data, you have the power. Yeah. So if we are not able to do that first, we will be beat it in the future. Yeah. And we don't want to do that. We want to be the first movers.
Exactly. Yeah, I remember when I first came to Visa, about a week into my job, there were a couple of different stories that people were describing about use cases for Visa. And one person from a developing part of the world said, you know, it's going to be great when we can ultimately deploy digital payments everywhere, because we have this one scenario of a mother who had two jobs and effectively after her two jobs got home exhausted and but then had to get on a bus for an hour to go pay someone in cash. Otherwise, there would have been a surcharge had she missed the payment. And I just realized at that exact moment, that's why I'm at Visa. Like, I mean, the notion of the mom getting on the bus to go make a payment, otherwise she's going to get a penalty, when it could have been as easy as a tap or a click, is exactly why I'm at Visa.
I want to add something. I think it's quite interesting to see that. We are all talking about mobility. And I think that one of the elements we have to keep in mind to succeed in innovation is that you cannot succeed alone now. It's impossible for a company to succeed alone to innovate. We have to work on platforms. It's exactly what we do, what we have with the robocar. But when we talk about mobility, you talk about the insurance for mobility, but you talk about the payment for mobility. You talk about the access to the mobility.
Right.
And if we work together, which is the case, you can create, for example, an app, what we are doing in the next weeks. We can create an app to propose to the people to access to this platform, and within this platform they can be insured, they will have Allianz inside, they can pay, they will have Visa inside, but the value proposition is not Visa or Allianz, it will be the app and the platform. And I think this is the real innovation we will have to create in the future.
That makes complete sense. I mean, I think also the categories you guys are in, that's a beautiful story that you told about the mother who has to go make a payment and you guys thinking about how you can facilitate that. And for you, it's about how do you keep people safe? How do you protect them? How do you make sure they're protected through their lives? So those are really beautiful companies in terms of what it is that you guys are facilitating. So I can see why you're so motivated to do what you do. I think we only have a couple of minutes left, so I thought maybe each of you could just leave the audience with some parting advice. I mean, I think it's very, very clear. You've said, set a vision, make sure you bring the people along. I do love that small budget for the pebble in the shoe. Here's something to fix your immediate problem. But let's say, you know, there's a great example. Let's say some of these people out here want to get started. How would they get started after they have their vision? What's the vision is, that's where we're going. What does step number one look like?
Well, I don't know if I give anyone individual advice, but I mean, I think, you know, it's evidence that you're here, that you're open to hearing kind of best practices and from others. And honestly, while I'm on this panel, and it's great, I mean, I've spent the majority of my time in Cologne kind of walking the floor and exploring what other companies are doing. I mean, I'm personally super inspired by, you know, people who have that ambition and that constitution to go off and take a risk and to create something and to come here and represent that and hope people care about it as much as they care about it. And, you know, to think about the families behind that person and that booth and who are all rooting for that success and investors. I mean, it's the human condition. And, you know, we're all here for a finite amount of time. And so I think we should try to make it matter.
And you, Jean-Marc?
two answers. I think that first of all, it depends on the age and the size of the company, because when you are a startup, you have no choice. Yeah. You have to succeed and innovate. But when you are a more traditional company like we are, even if you are not so big and strong than the Visa or Allianz, I think that if it's an African proverb, and said, if you want to know where you have to go, you have to understand from where you are coming. So I think it's quite important to understand what is your core value proposition. As an insurer, you know, it's one of my friends said the safest place for a ship is a harbor, but it's not the reason why the ship was built for.
Right.
So if we think that we have to keep the ship in harbor, we cannot be an insurer. And from the region, we were created for that, to accompany the people who are taking risk, who have courage in their life, who take risk, who dare to do things. So if you understand that, you immediately change your vision of the role of the company. And if the people around you understand that, they change the way they hear what you propose to them. We are here as an insurer not to insure. We are here to accompany the people who takes risk, which is completely different. And if you have this vision, of course you are obliged to invest in new business sectors. Of course you are obliged to support people like Denis Sverdlov with his crazy kinetic company, which is creating a semi-autonomous and autonomous truck. Of course, we have to meet the guys from Street Scooter here who are doing themselves, DHL, themselves becoming a car manufacturer. You are obliged to be there because you have to accompany them. So I think that you have to understand who you are, to understand where you have to go, and when you know who you are, it's not so difficult to define the objective and the vision.
Fantastic advice. Well, thank you so much, Jean-Marc. Thank you so much, Chris.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure.
Appreciate it.